everybody can hear me. Welcome to MOCA GA. My name is Ivy Tronkey. I'm the Programs and Events Manager, and welcome. It's great to have you here. We're so pleased to have Mario Petrirena talking tonight about his retrospective of over 30 years of artwork. All by the same artist. I've had people come into the museum and say, this is all by the same person. They spend a little time and start to see the themes. We're just so glad to have you here. Okay. And real quick, we do have a few other upcoming events at the museum I'd like to go over with you. All right. So a week from today, also at 6:30 reception, 7 o'clock, we're going to have a panel discussion going over kind of the legal aspects of immigration. We're on a panel of 3 experts, along with Mario, so make sure to come back.
Are you a legal expert?
You're an art expert. You're a visual art expert. So make sure and come back next week as well. We also have the Gathered exhibition coming up next month, where we have the call for entries for Georgia artists. So that's going to be on May the 13th. That reception starts at 6:30, so make sure to keep that in mind. Otherwise, it's time to delve into your long resume.
I know. I've been making art for 30 years. That's enough. I mean, just the fact that somebody's making art for 30 years is just the enough.
Okay.
No.
Oh, and I do have one more thing that we're just announcing for the first time tonight. On the last day of your exhibition, on the 29th, we're going to be releasing his catalog, and we're going to be announcing a time where Mario can come and sign your catalog. And the great thing is, admission will be free to the museum that day. So it's a great way to spend your Saturday. So look out for more details about that very soon. You don't want to talk about your MFA?
No, any of them happen. I mean, anyway, just the fact that I'm still making work should be enough. So we'll go from there. Okay, I'll start, but I'm sorry, I didn't mean to be rude, but I mean, I hate it when you go to these things and they talk on and on and about what people did. I just think that the fact that you're making art for 30 years is enough. So first off, I'd like to thank my wife, Susan, because I don't think any of this would ever have been possible without her. I don't know where I would really be if it wasn't for her. Crazy or dead. I'd like to thank David Golden and Annette for starting this museum, and special thanks to Annette for continuing to hang in there and support Georgia artists. So thank you, Annette. I would like to thank the staff, Amy, Jessica, and Emily, I guess, is gone. Eric, I couldn't have gotten this up without Eric. And Susan Lofton, who's probably not here, but she was very helpful in installing this artwork, and she's been a friend of mine for a very long time. Debbie Hudson and Robin Sandler for supporting my crazy ass all these years. Thank you to everybody for coming. Thank you to my friends from all over, including Moscow, but Idaho. So thank you for coming. I really appreciate everybody coming here. Years ago, Scott, I always get his name wrong, Belleville, did a talk, and he was in the big gallery, and he started it off by rattling off things that influenced him or inspired him, and I said, shit, I had that idea. I wanted to do that. So the tradition of artists being inspired by artists, I just thought I'd read off some things that have inspired me. Van Gogh's drawings, Joseph Cornell, Picasso's Guernica, Dwayne Michaels, Frida Kahlo, George Orr, Yoko Ono, lots of movies. In particular, everything is illuminated. You see inside Johnny Cash, Loretta Lynn, Roseanne Cash, Celia Cruz, Bert the Kid, God Only Knows by the Beach Boys, How Do You Stop by James Brown, killer song, the Alhambra in Spain, the Vietnam Memorial, the Ice Age Building by Frank Gehry in New York, Colon Cemetery in Havana, Cuba. That was my first real experience in aesthetics and beauty. The Prince and the Pauper by Mark Twain, To Kill a Mockingbird. Mrs. Stevens Hears a Mermaid Singing. Unaccustomed Bird by Jhumpa Lahiri. It's a book about an Indian American, but just really, really moved me. Drenched in Light by North, by Zora Neale Hurston. Truth and Beauty by Ann Patchett. Humor has always kept me going, so that's really, really important. The ocean and the sky. Okay, about the exhibition. So the layout of the exhibition is in really six parts. It starts with this section in here, and that's biography, family, narrative, personal, and memory. And it's not linear, so it's, you know, all kind of a gumbo. The second section, which is kind of like you go into a little hallway, that's hybrid, transition, duality, layered, complex. The third gallery is the gallery with the tombstones, is conflict, dispute, strife, discord, loss. The big gallery is beauty, transcendence, strength, humanity, and understanding. And then you end back here, which is mortality, transition, hope, remembrance, and impertinence. Then there's a special section over here with public, alternative, offering, exchange, and beyond. So I don't really know, you know, what really to say, except that it's been really interesting to look back on 30 years of art making. A lot of it, it seems like somebody else made, which is, in a sense, it's true, because you're a different person in all these parts of your life. But my work started out after graduate school. I had like a moment where everything changed for me, you know, we had this critique, and I had a professor who I thought didn't know anything. He was a little old man, and his name was Hobart Coles, and he did all these tests on glazes, and, you know, I was young, and I thought I was, you know, knew everything. And on my birthday, on November 19th, he came into my studio, and I had had this critique the first semester of graduate school, and I thought I was doing some experimental stuff, and he came in, and he said, yeah, they beat you up in graduate school, and they said all this crap, and so I just shut down, and I went right back to what I was doing before I got into graduate school. And he comes in and he said, "What happened?" And I thought, "What do you mean, what happened?" What happened was the critique. So it kind of shut me down. And he said something really simple, and he said, you know, basically he said, "When you're in the studio, you're on your own," you know. And I thought, yeah, he's right. So the studio for me has always been about silencing all the voices that say what you can and can't do. And silencing those voices to listen to myself is what it's all about. And there are a lot of voices in here. So that takes a lot of energy sometimes to get to that place, to just listen to yourself and do that. So that's basically what I try to do with my work. And it hasn't always been easy. Everybody thinks that making art is this kind of fun. Artist. It took years just to be able to say that I was an artist. Because when we were in graduate school, we had this friend. Her name was Emily, and she was like, "I'm an artist." And I always would think, "God, she's so full of shit." I mean, what does it mean to be an artist? It just seems so pompous and so, you know, like grandiose. So it took me a long time to ever, you know, to think. So I'm kind of one of those Christians that go around saying, "I'm trying to be a Christian. I'm trying to be an artist." And that's what the 30 years have been. I've trying to be an artist, whatever the fuck that means. So this first section is about family and biography, and it starts off with this piece, which is about my dad. Both my parents had passed away, and it was called Daddy Come Ride With Me. And my dad was, you know, but not real demonstrative, and he was the opposite of my mother, just more like me, loud and blah, blah. And so I did this piece about him, and somehow I came to terms with who he was. And so the text, there's some writing on it, and the text is about him. And that's something that happens in graduate school after, you know, all these semesters, the final semester of graduate school, I just kind of decided, I'm not letting anybody in my studio, I'm not listening to anybody, I'm just going to do my work. And that's when my work really shifts and it becomes personal, it becomes about, you know, things that are important to me, and that really, really changed. And a lot of it had to do with, I had heard Wayne Michael speak years before when I was in undergraduate school. And then a professor who we had who was very hot at the time introduced us to Frida Kahlo. So those two figures, Dwayne Michaels and Frida Kahlo, kind of introduced me to the personal. And that's when my work really shifts and I start to do these works. But that was about my dad. There's a piece back there with the mannequin that's about my mom. And then there's pieces about, you know, my wife and my son. And so everything in here for myself is some self-portrait. And it's not linear. I've kind of thrown things together because it just made sense to me, because I'm not a linear person. And I've gone back and forth on different things. The Statue of Liberty, that's about, you know, what liberty meant to my parents when they came here and what it means to me. The tree trunk is the South for me, which I've lived most of my life in the South. The little boat is, you know, everybody assumes Cubans came over on a boat, but I didn't. I came over on a plane. But the boat is, and then actually that piece on the left, it's like a column, that was about my mother, and I did that after she passed away. Which is kind of interesting to think about it in juxtaposed to this M, which is St. Mark, the mother of six, which my mother was, you know, was full of herself, and, you know, she had six kids, and she's very Catholic, and just filled with things, and, you know, then she was gone, and when my son was born, when Gregory was born, it really shifted and changed everything. It changed my understanding about my parents. It was just something really weird, you know, kind of happens with him. And so in a way it changed my work. So, you know, that's kind of this gallery. And then we go into transition, which is kind of hybrids. And then I do these, you know, these funny political things, which I call laughing to keep from crying, which is, humor is a very important part of who I am, and also I think of, in a way, a very important part of my Cuban side. And that's another thing I guess I need to talk about. I mean, I think I was, you know, I came when I was 8 years old. I grew up in a very Cuban household, so I lived my life, the beginning of my life was very much navigating those two things, and I call it like life on the hyphen. So I was born in Cuba, and then there was a long spell where you're kind of living on this hyphen, where you're trying to navigate these two worlds and never kind of really feeling like you belong to either one. And somebody, I don't know if Debbie Chapman is here, but she said to me, well, you really need to think about it the other way. You belong in both worlds. And that's, and it's true. And then at some point, then I went to Beijing in, what was it, 2005? And then I really knew I was American then. I never felt so American in my life. So now I feel like I'm a Cuban-born American. But I grew up in a house where, you know, if you said anything about Cubans, because we were busy trying to be Americans, and my father and mother never really learned English. So they would say, if I said anything about Cubans, my father would always say, what the hell do you think you are? So they're very, very, very proud of who, you know, where they came from. So that's a real big part of who I am. But it's not all of who I am. You know, I am something beyond all those things. So I guess we should kind of move on. Oh, that tall piece is filled with little knickknacks and things like that I collected through the years, including my art medal from high school. Which I was very, very proud. Any questions so far? No? Somebody was supposed to heckle me. So, in 1985 or something like that, I my parents were in a way, I don't know if they were political, but there was always talk about the struggles in Cuba and all those kinds of things. And I think in 1985 or something like that, there were, I don't know if it was the 40th anniversary of the Holocaust or something like that, and I started, you know, hearing all these things about it, and that's where a lot of this work comes from, with the little faces, like that piece and the piece with the barbed wire. And there's just this whole interest about and the big tombstones with the faces. And so that gives me permission to start to deal with things that are, you know, political. And which I always swore I wouldn't do. So, you know, I guess you can't help but be that way. So a lot of this work deals with loss, and it deals with struggles, and it deals with inhumanity and what we can do to each other as human beings. So it runs the spectrum. I mean, it runs from Katrina to Vietnam to, you know, like this is a very old piece. It's The Killing Fields. And so that's what this whole heavy duty gallery is, and including, you know, some really recent pieces with the flags, which is, you know, I work real intuitively, so I tend to collect things and I don't really know where it's going. And so I started collecting things that had to do with flags, so that's where the flag came from. And then, like, when I did the tombstone with the soldiers, I just collected photographs about soldiers. I didn't know where it was going, but I just really try to trust myself intuitively. And then it reveals itself. And a lot of times when I actually figure it out, I lose interest. So that's
What are these three here?
Those are, those are kind of newer work. But I was just thinking about loss and, you know, the cost of war and conflicts. And that's where all the little question mark comes from. I kind of, in a way, that kind of replaced the faces. Keeping count, whatever. But that's where they come from. So thank you. So then, from all this heavy duty stuff that you have to, like, you know, take in, I started thinking about these collages on the left are kind of my more current work. And then there's some over there that are current. And I started thinking a lot about, for a long time I've been looking at Islamic art, and you know, I guess it has to do, well, we went to Spain and we saw some things, but also when we were growing up in Cuba, there were, my grandmother's house had, you know, mosaic floors, and they had, you know, different things that kind of were influenced by all that Moorish stuff. And it took me a long time to give myself permission to do things that those voices again. And it's about, I think influences, for me, have to be digested and they have to become part of who I am before I can really say something, you know. It's really easy to say, oh, I'm going to do Islamic things or whatever. But, I, you know, anyway, at some point that gelled and I started doing this work on the left. So I wanted this gallery to deal with, I have this book on Islamic art and architecture, and I found myself just flipping through it, and it always made me feel good. I mean, it made me feel like just, the beauty made me feel just, you know, alive and not so down on things. So I wanted this gallery in a way to be about the redemptive quality of beauty, what beauty can do to feed you and to make you feel better. And I know beauty is something, you know, art is, it's not like shit to dealing with beauty, but it's something that I hope my work all has that element of it. I mean, at least it does for me, whether it's whatever. I mean, I think visual art is visual, and I hate when you go to an exhibition and there's this long ass thing that tells you how wonderful the art is, and then you read it and you go, it doesn't compute with what you're seeing. So, I mean, yeah, it'd be great if it was about, you know, but you're not gonna have some, you know, everybody's not gonna read about it, and everybody's not, and in the end, it's visual art, and I think that's important, and maybe that's passé, maybe that's because I'm old, blah, 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 I don't give a shit. I think it's what I believe. So anyway, this is about, hopefully, that's what it's about, the redemptive quality of beauty. And I had done a piece with the doilies, Agnes Scott, and I just always found them really fascinating and beautiful. And some of them are my mother's, and some of them are my grandmother's. And some of them are just found, which is something that I've always used in my work, and that might have to do, I've always found, because I don't have a whole lot of family things, I've always found family things very interesting. So, anyway, I just got this idea that it'd be interesting for them to be looked at as art works in themselves. And I think something really interesting happens when you don't look at them as something that's on a chair or whatever, and there's a certain amount of beauty to it. And then around on the other side is me, myself, and I, which is a self-portrait, and I really like the idea that you come around and you really see all these different self-portraits. But anyway, so these are newer work, and you know, the interesting thing about them is that I substitute teach sometimes, and to dazzle the kids, I do like snowflakes. And so I did snowflakes in there. They're really pretty. But then I started thinking about them seriously, and then I started cutting them out. But I was really conscious about how I was cutting them out and doing it. And then one day one flipped over on the back side, and the back side was way more interesting than the front side. So that's where all this kind of stuff starts to happen. So, you know, being open is something that's really important to my way of working. And it's something that, I don't know, maybe the fact that I come from, you know, two different places. You know, they say it takes a village to raise a child. In my case, it took two countries. and a whole lot of different people. So, it was really, it was interesting, and I thought they were beautiful, and, you know, I don't know. And anyway, any questions? Comments? Yes, ma'am?
About you are incorporating found objects into your work seems just so perfect. And which begins first? You have artwork going on and you find something that's perfect for
it? I'm always gathering.
The other way.
I'm always gathering. It can happen both ways. But I gather a lot. So I, if I'm drawn to something, like the tricycle in there, I always just zeroed in on that tricycle, and I don't know why, but I had to have the tricycle, so I traded somebody, and then years later, I saw a photograph of my brother, and he was standing next to a tricycle that was just like it. And when I mean just like it, I mean rusted and old like that, and it must have been something that somebody gave us when we came from Cuba, but I was drawn to the object. There's a great movie called The Red Violin, and it traces the life of the object. And that, I think that objects have a life and a story to them. So I'm drawn to things, and I try not to question it. So, you know, I found that box where the hands have turned, and I just found it, and I said, this is so cool. And I mean, I sat around in my studio for years until something hit me. That cage over there with the thing, same thing. I'm just drawn to the object, and then I find a purpose for it. But like the tall, skinny thing, and there's another one over there. My wife and I were walking in Decatur, and there were two of those things on the side of the street, and I was like, my God, this is so wonderful, I got to have it. And I'm like covering it up so we can run home and get the car, and she's like, Mario, nobody's gonna like that. And I was so worried that somebody was gonna steal it, you know, so I covered it up. And she's thinking I'm crazy, so, you know. So, but I knew immediately what to do with that one, as opposed to these that I kept around. And the doilies, I have an idea. This one on the corner with the X's, my mom did. And I always say that it was a tribute to Malcolm X. But she wouldn't have thought that. But, and the rest of them, there was a woman that had a shop named Granny taught us how, and she had wonderful windows, and I worked at Keon Gallery for a while, and I would walk by the windows, and I would say, Sylvia, your windows are great, so we got to be friends, and when she closed the shop, she always called me Mario. She's from Alabama. She said, Mario, I think you need these, and I said, I can't afford to buy all these things, and she sold me like a black garbage can bag full for $10. Aww. And she said, I know you'll know what to do with them. And I've used them like in three different installations. Sometimes they started out on the floor and now they've gone to the wall. But it was kind of neat that she thought that I could do something kind of, you know, with them. So I see this cube, which I have to thank Elizabeth Lye because she had a show before this. And she had, you know, made Eric make rooms. And so I said, I had done a version of the inside of this piece at Columbus, and I've done it at other places, but I never had it as a freestanding piece. So in a way, to me, it's like a self-portrait in that the outside skin is what kind of you show, and then you come around and then you see what a person is like inside. And the idea for that particular piece, me, myself, and I came from there was a series on TV, and it was about a pediatrician, and I don't even remember the name of the piece, but at the end, when the finale of the piece, there was a person the woman comes in with a baby, and then comes out a toddler, and then it keeps coming out, and then at the end you realize it's the same person. He's grown up. And so that was playing with the idea that it takes all these different views of who a person is to really show who you are, because we're complex and we're different.
I think they are in
this one. She made that one, and she made this one, and this one. And I think I think she might have made this. Yeah, my mother made bedspreads.
Yeah.
I have two or three of them.
Is this crochet?
Yes, crochet. Yeah. And what's interesting is to see when they're figuring things out.
Yeah.
You know, they work the patterns. And some of them are the same, but some of them are really unique. And they're like really working. My mother would make these little things, and they're like sketches, trying to figure out how to make something bigger. And so anyway, so this is a self-portrait, me, myself, and I. It covers, you know, it covers everything. And then the final room is mortality mortality and whatever. So I kind of used all kinds of old pieces, and I kind of made a new piece with the flowers, and all around it were sort of kind of like offerings or an altar. And so that's, you know, what that piece is about. And then in the corner is special projects, and there's different projects that I've done that have to do with postcards, or trying to do something beyond, you know, formal spaces and trying to interact with people, which is something that, you know, sometimes you feel so isolated. So I did a postcard project at the airport where I made 1,500 postcards, and I would, I had a show in the atrium, but it, and we printed out postcards, but as part of it, I would go two or three times a week, and I would engage people as they went by with this tower, and I would ask them if they like a postcard. And of course, in the age that we live in, everybody wanted to tweet about it, blah, 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 and that wasn't part of it. It was part about just encountering, rewarding the viewer for just happening to stop and partaking of something. Not tweeting about it, whatever. So, you know, it was, I had incredible experiences. I met people from all over the world, and you share these postcards. There were plenty of people that would run by, and they would be like, would you like a postcard? Because they thought you were trying to sell them something. No, and I'm like, it's free! And all of them, you know, and, you know, that kind of stuff. I had an old woman that said, what do I want a postcard for? I'm dying from cancer. Blah, blah, blah. I said, well, you might really shock somebody if you sent them. You know? Kind of stuff like that. I met people from Peru, and they were stranded at the airport, and I took them to dinner, and Susan, my wife, said, did you have to use such an expensive restaurant? I said, you have to try the biscuits, you have to try this. I was telling them to try all this food, and then, you know, she was like, but did you have to take them? But they were great, and the weird thing about it is the guy was like, anyway, I had incredible experiences from all over the world, and you learn about human nature. Like, people would come and they would want to take 5,000 postcards, and they were all original postcards. And there was this group. They were like, and I said, no, it's one per person. And then you get somebody that would come and you really like them. You said you could take more than one. And you go, oh no, no, I could possibly take more than one. So you got the whole spectrum of people. And it was really just, and the wonderful thing about it was that they didn't know any, you know, they didn't know who I was. They weren't taking anything because of, it was art or whatever. The idea was to, for you to take it and to mail it to somebody you loved. And that was all I was asking them to do. And that felt really good. It was a great experience. It was really, really interesting. And I've done other projects. I hope to do more. I like the whole idea of doing something beyond a formal space, and something that's, and that's where my Yoko Ono stuff comes from. I think that I think there's something really wonderful about having an exchange with somebody, and that it doesn't have monetary value. That it's something that just happens organically, and it's not a big deal. It's just kind of, you know, like seeing a flower bloom or seeing the sky or whatever. And so, anyway, I'm really, thank everybody for coming. And I'm really excited. The interesting thing about this for me has been that I'm really kind of excited about to see what comes next, which I didn't anticipate. And somebody asked me what I had thought about the exhibition and stuff. And one thing I do have to say is that I was amazed at how much bad shit I made. So that's a real important thing, because for every piece that's successful, there's a lot of shit. So that's the other thing that's really, you know, important, that it's a struggle, and it's a thing that you're constantly doing, and it's not, it's not always pretty.
Well, I had a question. So you said there was, you had hesitancy to make political work. I mean, a lot of your work is so biographically driven. How'd you shift? Like, what made you?
I think the political work started by saying that I was doing things about the Holocaust. So that was something that I was personally,
right.
So that kind of gave me the permission. I tend to do that to myself. I kind of tend to give myself permission in a roundabout way.
Yeah.
Because I never go straight to nothing. So that was, because I fought it for years. You know, my parents probably, everything was revolved around Cuba and how that affected them. And maybe it wasn't everything, but that's the way I saw it.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the piece with Henry Louis Gates.
And then it became kind of fun and humorous, and it really ramped up when George W. was elected, and which is really weird because there's not a single George W. in there. But that kind of maybe it's a generalization, but it's, humor is very important to the, Cuban culture, and that was a way to get things said. But anyway, if you have any questions or comments, I would appreciate that. Yes.
I'm curious, how did you go about saving, categorizing, chronicling 30 years of art in order to arrive at an exhibit like this? And I was particularly fascinated by saying that you felt like other people had made some of the bodies of work, and what it feels like to show that under your name now. And just that idea of that time span is fascinating to me.
I don't know how I arrived at it. When Nanette came and, we decided to do this, I just immediately kind of started thinking about it. And I had to start thinking about things that had been sold and where they ended up and that kind of thing. But like, there's a piece with like a narrow thing with some barbed wire around it, which is with a set of bust forms that I did. And I always I'm not one of those people that I love my work. It's so great. I wish I felt that way. I kind of envy that. But that was one particular piece that I remember. And I remember that Lisa Tuttle bought it. And I wonder if she still has it. It was like an AIDS auction once upon a time. And that was one. And there's been certain pieces that have been like touchstones that kind of led to things. But I don't know. I mean, I just, my parents' pieces, maybe because they passed away and I had them. One of them was up in the attic, and I thought, I wonder if it's still in one piece, and it was. There was just certain things that, I think I was telling somebody that, your life as an artist or as a person probably is just, it's a road, and you have certain people that illuminate your path, and sometimes your path is really dark, and you don't have anybody helping you out. And in some ways, some of the pieces were specific to that time, and they just, I knew that I had done personal work, I knew that I had shifted into other things and gone back and forth, so I just kind of went through my head and thought about the different phases and what would I consider important, and just kind of backtrack. So that's, all right. I wish I had been better about keeping track of things, but I visited other, people that collected my work, and it was interesting to look back on things, and I just went by gut feeling. Really felt strong about something that had to be in the show. I just kind of went with that, and there was a lot of people talking, and I just shut it down and just listen to myself, and I just went with that. And like I said, it's not easy. But I put blinders on and just kept this is what I had to do.
Is there anything kind of along the way that you feel you did? Or was it really just thinking about it only at this moment in time?
What do you mean?
Well, all artists working could be thinking about, oh, I'm going to have that show.
Never thought about that. The way that I work is, when you're in the studio, you're working and you shut the world out. It's everything that happens outside of the studio that's the shit for me, you know. So when you close the door to the studio, it's all about what's going on in there. And if stuff starts creeping in, shut it down. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to work. But that's just me, you know. All I can say, that's just, you know, that's the way I do it. But, yeah. No, and, you know, I think years ago, I won't call out names, but somebody told me that, you know, people were ready for success or whatever, and I thought, you know, I'm really not ready for success, whatever that means. Because that would mean all these complications. Whatever success is, you know, and that would complicate a whole lot of things. So, in my obscurity, I've had the freedom to do my work, you know, which I don't know, it's been a mixed blessing, in a way, yeah. I don't know if that helps at all.
Mario,
yes,
what kind of a space do you work in?
What kind of space? When I used to have a studio once upon a time at Nexus, and when they were tearing down the old building, I had gotten an NEA, Robin Sandler had a show, and actually sold a lot of stuff, and my wife said, we had bought this old house in Decatur, and she said, why don't you build a garage studio? And that's what I did, and that's it. It's a junky place filled with crap everywhere. Yeah. Like Annette came and she goes, I didn't know there was this much stuff. She goes, where did it keep coming from?
No.
I didn't know there was that much shit in there either. So, yeah, so, you know, but it was just packed away and it's really hard to see sometimes. So this has been like a luxury to see it, not where it has room to breathe Yeah, and I see the show as one big piece, in a way. So, any other?